I've got a sermon for you today that I titled, Why Mama Obama? And there's a reason. There's a lot of people around this country asking the question, why Obama, Mama? And I'm going to tell you, the reason Obama was elected again in America is because you want Obama to be your mama. And that's the problem in America today. You want the government to be your mama. And because you want the government to be your mama, you're going to get what you ask for. You're going to get what you want. But what I have to say to America today and to American Christians, many of them, I hope you're listening somewhere. Maybe you stumbled on sermon audio somehow and you were attracted by the title. But I'm telling you that if you think the government's going to be your friend when it becomes your mama, if you think that you're going to be blessed, you're wrong. You're going to be cursed. My text for you today is Judges 18, verse 7. Then five men departed and came to Laish. They just lay around everywhere in Laish. And saw the people that were therein, how they dwelt what? Careless, after the manner of the Zidonians. Quiet and secure. Hey, y'all listen. There was no magistrate in the land that might put them to shame in anything. Do you see that? There was no magistrate in the land that might put them to shame in anything. And so you know the result was verse 27. They smote them with the edge of the sword and burnt the city with fire. They smote them with the edge of the sword and burnt the city with fire. I have to ask a question. I wonder why there were no magistrates in the land. I believe they didn't want any magistrates. I believe they didn't want any men. They didn't want any leaders. Not real leaders. They wanted mamas. But I'm going to tell you something. They wanted a different kind of mama. They wanted a mama to spoil them. And I'm going to tell you, they ended up in destruction. They ended up in destruction. Let's pray. Dear Father, be with the preaching of Thy Word, Lord. We know that Your Word is on time. You've given us this book of Judges to teach us lessons, God. We do pray we will apply the lessons therein in the name of Jesus. Amen. You know, what's true of a city can be true of a whole nation. Y'all listening? What's true of a city can be true of a whole nation. Do you know you can end up with a whole nation with no magistrates? Oh, listen, don't get me wrong. When you look at all the bureaucracy and all the rules and regulations, you said everywhere you look's a magistrate. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about true, godly, manly leaders that'll do what's right because it's right and tell you what you need to hear and what you should hear. And when there's no magistrates in the land, when everybody's compromised, when your politicians are compromised, when your pastors are compromised, when there's no men in the homes anymore, they're all compromised, I'm telling you, you're going to be smitten by the edge of the sword. You're going to end up a country in destruction. People say a third world nation, that this country's going to end up in poverty and gangs and drug warfare and just a total poverty. I'm going to tell you, it'll be worse than that. And one problem is we're dwelling careless here in America. And there's nobody to put you to shame. And when politicians try to speak the truth, they're demonized. They can't survive. They get attacked by their own party. Alexander Fraser Tytler, who died in 1813, was right when he said, patriotism always exists in the greatest degree in rude nations and in an early period of society. Like all other affections and passions, it operates with the greatest force where it meets with the greatest difficulties. But in a state of ease and safety, as if wanting its appropriate nourishment, it languishes and decays. It is a law of nature to which no experience has ever furnished an exception that the rising grandeur and opulence of a nation must be balanced by the decline of its heroic virtue. Its manly virtues is what I would say. That as things grow up, as the nation becomes prosperous and careless, all of the heroic virtues are pushed to the side and a bunch of slimy, sleazy, lazy, compromised, crooked gangster types end up in authority over the nation. And when you get to a place where there are no real magistrates, when leaders simply tell people what they know they want to hear so they can use them and manipulate them for selfish ends, we're ripe for destruction. The Bible predicted this situation in Jude. It says these are murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lust. What happens when you have a whole nation of murmurers and complainers walking after their own lust? You're going to get the leaders you deserve. Their mouth speaking great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of advantage. What happens when you have leaders that use big swelling words, but their whole point is to make you feel good about yourself? Their whole point is to tickle your ears for their own advantage. When you have pulpits filled with people that tell you what you want to hear for their own advantage, when you have politicians that tell you what you want to hear for their own advantage, we're in a mess in America. This is what positive thinking is. Positive thinking is give them a firm handshake, look them right in the eye, tell them something flattering about themselves, and send out a thought signal that you're so positive you make them write you a check. They have books, it's witchcraft, that tell people how to basically praise people so they'll write you a check. The business world is filled up. Well, now the politicians, it's the sorcery, the bewitching of the people, and politicians are using it for their own advantage, telling you what they know you want to hear. There comes a time when the majority of the people will not endure sound doctrine. Now listen to me, in church or state. What happens when you want to endure sound doctrine in the church? Well, you're in a mess. What happens when you will not endure sound doctrine in politics? You know, there's doctrine in politics. God has just weights and balances. He has all types of things on how to elect leaders, what type of leaders you ought to have. He has all types of things to say that sound doctrine applied to the civil realm. But they will not endure sound doctrine in the civil realm. He has a lot to say about borrowing money, about debt, about all of the foolish spend now, pay later, curse the future generation. Does God have a whole book of Proverbs about these types of principles? The Bible is filled with these types of principles of how to be blessed and how to follow sound doctrine. But anyone who brings sound doctrine in the political area will not be endured. Will not be endured. It says in 2 Timothy 4, the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Folks, that's in the church. That's in the civil arena. But after their own lusts, shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ear. You can rephrase that. They will heap to themselves pastors that will tell them what they want to hear. You could rephrase it by way of application. They will heap to themselves politicians who will tell them what they want to hear. If a politician stood up and says, you're in a mess, all of your little programs and stuff have to be cut. It's not an example of whether you like it or whether you don't like it. You have to cut your little programs, and we're going to have to cut all of this spending and empire building and all that we're doing. It's going to have to be downsized so we can bring everything back under control. They're hated. They're despised. You understand that? They have itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. It says in Micah, if a man walking in the spirit and falsehood do lie, saying, I will prophesy unto thee of wine and of strong drink, he shall even be the prophet of this people. That's the pastor we want. Tell me that I can party and get blessed. That's the president we want. Tell me that I can throw a party and the government will pay for it and I'm going to be blessed. Let me show you something that's quite amazing. Do you know the lies of the false prophets of this age are actually used by the civil leaders to control the masses? Look at Jeremiah 5. The prophets prophesy falsely. That's a mess, isn't it? And the priests bear rule by their means. By what? I believe it's the means of the false prophets. Basically, this is saying, the civil leaders, because it was a theocracy in Israel. What this is saying is the civil leaders are ruling the people by using certain prophets, certain
people that say the right things and make you feel good about everything. And that's how they're controlling the people with this false prophecy. Now, that's a bad situation, isn't it? But look at what God says. My people love to have it so. Which means if you try to expose it, you're going to ruffle feathers, step on toes. The people want it this way. They want a situation where their leaders are telling you lies. If you sum all of this up today and somebody says, why, Mama, Obama? Say, child, that's how the people want it. They want it this way. Well, Mother, isn't it a lie? There's no real change coming. And we're just digging ourselves deeper so our doom and destruction will be greater. Isn't this obvious? Yes. Well, why does everybody think that it's going to be so good? And that we can continue doing the same thing over and over. And somehow we're going to end up blessed. The answer is this. Because people want it that way. They want to believe the lie. Now, with this introductory foundation, I want to take a look at the state of America and the recent election of Obama. I have a title, the sermon, Why Mama Obama, and you can take it in a dual fashion. And I don't think Obama would find it disrespectful. From what I gather, he's perfectly happy playing the role of a codependent mother. You know what psychologists call a codependent mother? They say it's a mama who spoils the children, who rescues them from everyone, who tries to hold them accountable, which is what psychology is, by the way. And anything that tries to help a child grow up, the codependent mother is really just a mama that spoils her children that won't obey God. Do you understand that? She's obsessive. She's addicted. And what she's addicted to is bailing her children out and protecting him from any responsibility. Anything that allows him to become a man, she's got to get in the way and protect him and mother him and take care of him and rescue him and save him. And it keeps the children weak and dependent. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. But when I look back on it, I see where I made a mistake. I didn't think Obama would get elected in America the first time. But here's where I messed up. I listened to him speak. I listened to the substance of what he was saying. And here's what I said. I know it was wrong. I said, there's nothing logical whatsoever he's saying. I said, he hasn't said anything. He has gone on and rambled. He said nothing. And what I said is nobody can be stupid enough in America to listen to that and believe it. I was wrong. Obama got elected. And I had to shake my head and say, you know, I totally misinterpreted the common sense of Americans today. I was asked the other day, who do you think will get elected? I watched the debate between Obama and Romney. And when I heard what Obama, and listen, I'm not a Romney fan, believe me. But when I heard what Obama was saying, I realized he's not even debating. He's not even giving you a logical argument. There's no logic to anything the man says. And I said, so there's no way that he could get elected. And I thought that Romney was just a little plan to bring him in and, you know, the Masons will be happy giving you a Mormon, unifying all religions, and he'll do his little thing, and then maybe Hillary will come in next, and they'll just keep bouncing back and forth. But I really thought Romney would be elected this time because nobody could be ignorant enough to fall for the same stuff again that they fell for the first time. Then they said, well, Obama got elected. And I started thinking, now, being as illogical as he is, how could Americans elect somebody? And then I realized, wait just a second, Joey. They're not voting on the basis of logic. The reason he went up there and didn't say anything was because it's not about somebody thinking. It's about you feeling. It's about you having sympathy that it's his anniversary and this mean old person is basically picking on him and all he wants to do is help you. And he's just trying to give people some money and the mean rich person's trying to take it away from you. It's not about logic. It's about creating a certain feeling. So what I did after Obama got elected, the first thing I did was pick up a book by Goebbels, which is an Antichrist. He's basically the head of Hitler's propaganda party. I said, I need to read his book on propaganda again. And basically, he's going to tell you everything, how it all works. It's not about logic. It's about controlling the masses. Then I read Edward Bernays again, which is the propaganda leader in America. I read through his book again. I read about five other books. This is what I did on the way home on propaganda. And it all came back to me. I'm like, you know, I could have saw all this. It's whoever is the most unreasonable, whoever is not debating, whoever is not being logical, whoever is telling the people what they want to hear, that's who's going to be elected in America. And you're sitting there listening to logic and reason and trying to figure out just a little tidbit of it somewhere. And now I totally remember. See, when you have a spoiled child who wants to keep nursing, they're going to fight not to be weaned. And if daddy tries to come and say it's about time he learns to eat some food, then a mama who spoils children is going to say that would be terrible. That's going to be horrible. And she's going to protect that child its whole life. And she's very selfish because she's making an idol of the child. And she wants to keep the child weak and dependent. But the child wants to stay weak and dependent. So you've got a mutual relationship there. You got a spoiled child who wants to stay spoiled. And you got a mama who benefits from keeping the child weak and dependent. And now you have our government today. You have people that are spoiled children in America who are dependent upon government, and they want to keep it that way. And you've got a government that profits from keeping you dependent, that keeps you from self-reliance, that keeps you from being able to take care of yourself, that keeps you from basically ever able to break free. So you end up with a big son who's been pampered and coddled and protected to such a degree. No one protected him from his worst enemy, which is his self and his selfish mama, who in reality uses him for her own addictions. And it's really hatred. It's not love. If that's how you raise your children, you don't love them. But I love them so much I have to protect them. No, you love yourself. You love yourself. You're addicted just like any drug addict is. You're addicted to spoiling your children, and you're going to send them to hell so they can have the same hellish torment that you experience every day. God says it's hatred. It's idolatry. The Bible said in Proverbs 13, he that spareth his rod hateth his son, but he that loveth him chasteneth him betimes. And I'm telling you, we got a spoiled generation of Americans. There's no accountability. And government has become your mama. Obama has become your mama. And there's generations of people all around America that want Obama to be their mama. And Obama is going to stand up and protect you from those mean old people that want you to be accountable. And he's going to defend you from them. And he's going to protect you so you can get behind him. And he's going to take up for you like every spoiled mama has to take up for her child. Do you like being a child? See, I think more of you. You say, that pastor sure is mean. No, I think highly of you. I think you're more than a child. The New York Post recently ran a recent headline. It's pretty much a wicked pornographic paper, but the headline reportedly was, God hates us. Isn't that something? Noting after the devastation caused by Sandy, the region now has been hit by another snow and ice storm. So New York responded by, God hates us. Then reportedly it went on to blast them by saying, but we have an angel. And it put a lewd model up, half naked. And you know, that's just blasphemy. That's where we're at in America. God's to blame for this. But right there in the middle of their blasphemy, they can't cease from their pornography. This is America. Blame God, but never blame yourself. That's what spoiled people do. Spoiled people never take responsibility for their action. They always see themselves as victims. Even if they're meth addicts, talking to a lady that sees people coming and sometimes burglarizing, she said that they come in and think, because you have it, I deserve to have it. You don't deserve to have it. It ought to be shared by everybody. And that's the mentality of a meth addict who says, if you have it, you ought to give it to me. You have no right to it. And this is what the whole nation, they're like a bunch of drug addicts that are spoiled children that say, if somebody else has it, they don't deserve to have it, and the government ought to take it from them and give it to me. It's just not fair. I wrote a book trying to restore accountability first among God's people. And as I said earlier, God's spoiled children threw a temper tantrum. That's how they feel about accountability. I don't agree with Ron Paul with everything, but he's trying to at least restore some financial accountability in America. They threw a temper tantrum. They went crazy. Wherever there's accountability, people are going to go crazy. Because that's what spoiled children do when you take the lollipop out of their mouth. They throw a fit. So whoever's going to fix anything has got to take the lollipops out of their mouth. Pastors are going to have to take the lollipops out. Politicians, men somewhere have got to take the lollipops out. Get rid of the suckers. But then the people are going to throw fits and cry and throw tantrums. So what do? You're in a mess in America today. Does God hate New York? It all depends on how you define hate. It's not a yes or no answer. In love, the theologians have understood in the Bible, there's a benevolent love and a complacent love. God loves everyone benevolently. He loves New York, even the worst sinners in New York, and He wants them to do right so they can be fully blessed. You know that? God loves New York. God loves the people of New York. God is love, and He benevolently causes His rain and His sun, and He loves the people and wants them to be saved and do right and be blessed. But God does not delight in open sinners. He does not get good feelings from anyone that openly sins and rebels against Him. People who cover their sins and play the victim. Remember Adam and Eve, after they sinned, you see this, they began to blame. Adam blamed his wife, and the wife blamed the serpent. And this blame casting, this playing the victim, has been with us ever since. But today, it's more open. So let me make one thing clear. The serpent and his ancient propaganda is behind all of this. The serpent has deceived the Eves of America. But we're not merely victims, is my point. The people love to have it so. My people love to be deceived. They want to be deceived. So you could change this in America, but the majority of people want to be deceived. They want to believe the lie. In Isaiah 30, it says, which say to the seers. You know what a seer is? Somebody that sees. They say to the seers, see not. And to the prophets, prophesy not unto us right things. Speak to us what? Smooth things. Prophesy to see. You mean you want me to tell you no matter what you do, that you're going to end up blessed and there'll never be a whipping, there'll never be any destruction coming. God is just going to bless you and He doesn't even see your sin whatsoever. And you could just go on and keep sinning. Your family's going to be blessed. You're going to be blessed. And when you stand before Jesus, you're going to be blessed. That's a smooth sermon, isn't it? And the people say, I want a smooth sermon. Tell me that everything's going to go right with Obama. Tell me in politics. Give me a smooth sermon. Tell me we can just keep doing what we're doing and we're going to continue. See, the real problem is not that God hates us. It's that people love themselves so much in such a selfish way, they end up hating themselves. They elect leaders who hate them. They don't elect leaders who love them. They elect leaders who hate them. And that's how they want it. They want smooth things. They want lies. So let me ask the question and then answer it for you. Why Obama? Why did Obama get elected? And listen, voting and deception and puppets and people control, put that aside. It's not even necessary. I'm not saying it doesn't go well. It's not necessary. When you got propaganda and they use it the way they do, it's not necessary. The people will vote for Obama. You don't have to lie. You don't have to steal election. They want Obama. Get out here on the street and talk to them. They're happy about it. They sit in front of that television. They think he's going to bless you. Why Obama? America. Why did Obama get elected? Many Christians around America want to know. I'll give you reason number one. Because the people want to be deceived. They want to believe the lie. 2 Thessalonians says, for this cause shall God send them strong delusion that they shall believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth but have pleasure in unrighteousness. You can believe lies in the spiritual realm and you can believe lies in the civil realm. But the point is, people want to be lied to. I found that Ben Adams wrote an article called Government Gifts Are Dangerous in the El Paso Herald Post, December 5th, 1961. He's going to quote an ancient teacher, not an ancient teacher, an early teacher in Britain, Alexander Fraser Tytler, who we've already heard from. That's who he's attributing the quote to. I can't find it any earlier than 1961. There's a lot of debate about who actually said these words. It's not really important to me. I know that I have it here recorded in 1961. I also have it recorded in 1964. Ronald Reagan even recorded the words in 1965. So I don't care ultimately who said it. What I want you to know is that in 1961, they're quoting a forefather who uttered these words. A democracy cannot exist as a permanent form of government. It can only exist until the majority discovers it can vote itself largesse or gifts out of the public treasury. After that, the majority always votes for the candidate promising the most what? Benefit. Romney had to stand up running for the Republican side that's supposed to counter the Democratic, we're going to give you whatever you want, welfare. Normally the Republican stands up and says, we don't need welfare, you're destroying America. Now the Republican has to stand up, I never said I'm going to lower taxes, and that's a sell product. To run in America today, even as a Republican, you have to say, I won't lower your taxes. Wait a minute, I thought people wanted their taxes lowered. No, they understand now that if you lower my taxes, you take away my benefits. So they want their benefits, so they're watching the policy. You're going to take away my benefits? You're going to take away my mama? So once the people learn, whoever promises the most benefits, with the result the democracy collapses because of the loose fiscal policy ensuing, always to be followed by a what? Dictatorship! This has been going on. That's 1961. This has been going on for decades. Ben Adams goes on to say in 1961, through the practice of the voters, voting themselves largesse, they are destroying their own personal freedoms and liberties, not only today, but tomorrow also. We have come to the point that those people feeding at the government trough are selfishly seeking more from the same trough. If Americans want slavery, they can continue looking to the government for their support. All right, where did these wise men say it's going to end up? Slavery, dictatorship. Where's it ending up right now? Slavery, dictatorship. I'm not a slave. Really? They just had a report that 3/4 of Americans will accept a full body search just to get on a plane. They will accept anything the government wants to do as long as they get to have their little bit of biscuit or doggy treat or whatever the government gives them. Romney made a big mistake now. They caught him in a speech one day saying that 47% of people are dependent upon the government. Actually, I think the number's higher. I think we already surpassed that there's a majority of people not paying into, at least everybody's paying some way. But my point is, those on welfare are pretty much outnumbering those that are not. Romney said the 47% dependent upon the government are unlikely to be swayed by campaign promises or tax cuts. So basically he said 47% of these people are on so much welfare that government has become their mama. They're not going to vote for me. Now, of course, he has a mask on. He's pretending to be conservative. But what he said was, 47%, you've already got Obama because you're giving them the welfare lie. What did Obama do? Well, you're speaking about my people. You're speaking about these people that are on welfare. You're making them feel bad. So he came and ran to the rescue. We can't have any responsibility whatsoever. So he came and defended the people. And he defended it so good with his propaganda that Romney had to get down on his knees, crawl before the camera and say, I'm sorry, I've done a bad thing. I said that 47% of people are on welfare and that you would probably vote for Obama, and I was trying to hold you accountable, and I shouldn't have done that, and I apologize. That was a naughty thing of me to say. That's how bad we are in America. That's how bad we are in America. That's how bad things are in America. So what has Ron Paul said about it all? In Washington Times, he says, Ron Paul, election shows U.S. far gone. Representative Ron Paul, whose maverick presidential bid shook the GOP, said in the wake of this week's elections that the country has already veered over the fiscal cliff. And he sees no change of riding ship in a country where what? Too many people are what? Dependent on government. People do not want anything cut, he said. They want all the bailouts to come. This is what a lot of these Democrat liberals, they put Ron Paul on. And they say, oh, wow, we agree with you about civil liberty. This government's becoming a big dictator, and we're tired of it. And so we agree with you. So what do we need to do? Ron Paul said, well, unravel it. Quit depending upon it so much, and let's get out from under it. And they're like, yeah, I like that. Then they said, what are you going to cut? So, oh, Department of Education? We can't cut that. And he started listing all the things. Let's cut. I don't want that cut. We need all these things. They want all the bailouts to come. They want the Fed to keep printing the money. And they don't believe that we've gone off the cliff or are even close to going off the cliff. What do you think about that? Nelson Holtberg of AFR said Karl Marx was asked once how he could justify advocating a political system of slavery for the individual, which is what socialism is. He replied that socialism is not slavery. It's a new kind of freedom. Welcome. Welcome to the new America. As all perceptive students of history know, the intellectuals of Europe bought into the Alice in Wonderland sophistry that plunged into the 20th century nightmare of collectivist tyranny. Do you realize every one of those dictators that came in came to the oppressed people and said, I'm the people's party. I'm for the people. I'm going to deliver you from those mean rich people. And the people got behind them and brought them to power. And once they came to power, they took the mask off. And basically, you ended up working on a factory farm. Basically, you were a slave. One of Ayn Rand's powerful insights in Atlas Shrugged is that dictatorships take over people because the what? The people actually what? Approve of them. She called it the sanction of the victim. This attitude now permeates the American electorate. The great majority of Americans are demonstrating that they actually want to be enslaved. A majority of American voters indicated that they believe government owes them a living, along with health care, security, and self-esteem. They indicated that they believe rich people don't earn their wealth. They steal it from the kindly masses by siphoning off the surplus productivity of their labor and reducing them to grinding poverty. Justice and prosperity cannot be built by catering to slothful masses with theoretical fallacies. So as I said, to understand or just get a review of how this works, I began to read Joseph Goebbels, wicked right minister of propaganda in Germany. Here's what he said. Out of all his nonsense, this is the one quote that I took home. We must defend propaganda. A totalitarian state cannot survive without it. We must mold propaganda and education. So to control the people in the Nazi regime, they had to have propaganda. And propaganda was mixed with education. Remember the great Luciferian, Manly P. Hall, the infamous Luciferian, said that we must use public school, we must use this propaganda, the same Nazi propaganda, and that is how we're going to control the people. Now, you say, what is propaganda? Talking about the wicked propaganda that I'm discussing, the way it works is this, and I want you to remember this. Propaganda works by finding out what you want to believe anyway. You got to know, you got to research. What does she really want to do? What does he really want to do? What do they really want to believe? And once I figure out what they want to believe, then propaganda works by removing any objections and helping you lie to yourself. That's what propaganda is. Helping you lie to yourself. The adulterous woman in the book of Proverbs. Why did she say, the good man is away. He's gone on a far journey. Because she thought out what's going to be his possible objection. She knew what his lusts were. But she had to basically remove the obstacles of his rational mind. That's what propaganda does. Find out what people really want to do. Manipulate them to do that and use it for your own ends. Help them lie to themselves and feel good about their decision so they don't have any guilt. And whatever rational objections come up, demonize them, remove them, and help the people. And it doesn't have to be true. It doesn't have to even be logical. You just got to give them something. It's just a fetus. Well, you already know they want to abort it because they don't want responsibility. So you have to give them something that they can grab onto, and they don't want to hear anything else. You've already given me the propaganda. Bernays, the nephew of Freud, father of public relations and propaganda in America, died in 1995. He said in his book, Propaganda, we studied the whole book in here just to see how these wicked people work. And to see how the devil works, you can see it right there in Genesis chapter 3 if you want to know how propaganda works. Did he appeal to Eve's rational mind? Did he come and give her all these nice little reasons? No, he appealed to her feelings, did he not? He appealed to her lust. But he didn't just do that. He kicked down whatever objection she might have. But he did it while she was lusting. And that's what you have to do. That's how propaganda works. Edward Bernays in 1928 said the conscious and intelligent manipulation of the organized habits and opinions of the masses is an important element in democratic society. Those who manipulate this unseen mechanism, he's talking about himself, of society constitute an invisible government, which is the true ruling power of our country. People talk about invisible government and the hidden man behind the scene. Wait a second, folk. Whoever's running the propaganda machine in America is who's controlling the country. In their democracy, this is how it works. You decide. It's your decision. The people decide. After being manipulated to decide the way they want them to decide. Now you say, well, I made the decision. Well, sure you did. But you didn't understand the psychological bewitching. They sit down and think of how to manipulate you to say, I want slavery. Look what happened in California. I don't want my food being labeled GMO. What do you mean you don't? What? You wouldn't rather know? By the time they get done with the propaganda, they have the people screaming, we don't want to know that it's GMO. Well, this is powerful stuff, isn't it? It's powerful. It's so powerful, he started bragging about some of the things he did. He said, yeah, the pork companies wanted me to sell bacon. And so what I did was basically, I figured out what makes people decide what to eat. And it was probably more true then than it is now. But he realized whatever the doctor says is healthy, people are going to do. So he went to a bunch of doctors and said, hey, sign this thing telling me pork is healthy. And they said, okay. So now people sit down and you don't really eat eggs and steak. You eat eggs and bacon. I hope you don't eat eggs and bacon, but you understand my point. Eggs and bacon. Bacon and eggs. Everybody does that, right? Well, everybody does it once the propaganda people tricked you into it by putting out magazine ads that said, doctors agree that bacon in the morning with your eggs is so good for you. They're the same doctors that said, doctors agree that smoking is so good for you. Crisco is great. Eat your plastic. It'll be good for your heart. Well, now you look at how insane that is. But he bragged, we made a whole generation eat bacon in the morning. That's how powerful we are. You just tell these dumb people, these foolish people, that the experts, see, this is what he would do. Remember the Liberty Sticks, you know. The tobacco companies want women to smoke. But women don't want to smoke. They think it's gross. So he has models march up and he throws an event. You always got to have an event somewhere. And then the news broadcasts the event. And then they show across America these models marching with cigarettes, calling them torches of liberty, you know, Liberty Sticks. So now he identified smoking with women's lib. So now if you're for women's lib, you're going to smoke, right? Because you've come a long way, baby. He went on to continue to make tobacco identifiable with Apple Pie America. Don't you like, I read an ad the other day in an old magazine I had, and it says, don't you love the country? And it shows people smoking, you know. So loving the outdoor country life is identified with smoking. He would generate a big event, then the events would generate news, and the news made it appear normal, and it made a demand for what he was selling. He was actually influenced by his buddy Walter Lippmann. And Walter Lippmann, in the American Opinion in 1922, says, whatever we believe to be a true picture, we treat as if it were the world itself. The only feeling that anyone can have about an event he does not experience is the feeling aroused by his mental image of that event. Access to the real environment must be limited before anyone can create a pseudo-environment. I argue that representative government cannot be worked successfully unless there is an independent expert organization for making the unseen facts intelligible to those who have to make the decisions. My conclusion is that public opinions must be organized for the press. So this Lippmann and these fellows, basically they said you have to have a propaganda machine that decides how America is going to feel about certain things, and then they feed you that impression so you end up feeling about a situation the way they want you to feel. Well, of course, television nowadays is even more powerful because it can actually give you the images. And people see what they see and they believe it represents the real world. They see somebody doing something and they say everybody must be doing that. So your feelings are manipulated. And this is no secret. Christians and conservatives have known that television does this for years. But they continue to drink in the propaganda, every one of them thinking they're immune to it. In fact, I read a book by conservative Ben Shapiro. He grew up around Hollywood, and he wrote a book called Primetime Propaganda. And he argues that there's an obvious agenda. He said, you can look at the television show. The father is portrayed as stupid. Friends are exalted over family. Out-of-wedlock children are exalted. He talks about one scene where you have lesbian mothers basically deciding that now there's three parents of the child, and they were thinking it's such a horrible thing, but the whole show climaxes with basically this lesbian mother saying, you know, I grew up without hardly any parents at all, and now this child will have three of them, three people that really care about it. Isn't that wonderful? And they play the music, and everybody's sitting there watching the sitcom. They're just drinking in. They're made to feel a certain way about something. We know that's propaganda. But people across this country and Christian churches are saying, why Obama? But they are all sitting home being manipulated by this propaganda. And it's so bad that Ben Shapiro says, you know, my generation, even though we know this is going on, it's just too much fun to get rid of. That's how he concludes the book. It's just too much fun. You got to be realistic. We can't get rid of the television. We have too much fun watching it. So he basically leaves you in this hopeless situation of there's nothing really we can say about it. In researching propaganda, I realized the subject's filled with deceptive propaganda about the subject of propaganda. The propagandists want you to think they're saving you from propaganda. They label our rebellion against Hollywood as a slippery slope to fascism. They argue like drug dealers. They say the people want it. They want the slime. But what does a drug dealer do? He helps create a demand for it, right? You'll read that propaganda was the Red Scare, where everybody thought communists were taking over the country. They call that propaganda. So you read entire books about propaganda, and they'll say propaganda is when they used to think the communists were coming. So there's propaganda that's going to try to help you, save you from propaganda. And it's all summed up by people saying, have you ever heard the propaganda that Obama is a Marxist? They think Obama is a Marxist, and they call that propaganda. You see how that game works. Therefore, anything that cuts through and exposes real propaganda will be called propaganda. Wow, it's quite a game, isn't it? Quite a game. But let me conclude my point by simply saying that people voted for Obama because they were moved to do so. The feeling was created. They feel that he will bring change. They feel that he understands their pain. They feel that he's trying to help them get handouts, and that these mean rich people who run the businesses are trying to keep them from getting these handouts. They feel that he makes them feel good about wanting government to be their nursing mother. And this brings me to the second reason for Obama. The second reason Obama was elected in America is a majority of women and young people elected Obama. So they went after, and this is no, but believe me, I'm not trying to say anything demeaning about women. I'm telling you, they went after the target they knew they could most easily manipulate with feeling. Not because women are bad or foolish, but because God made women to be mothers and to be empathetic and sympathetic and to have all those wonderful gifts, but he made a couple to be in the home, a husband and wife, where they could hopefully balance out one another. And she has her role to play, and he has his role to play. But when you have a society that basically sits before this propaganda, they're able to manipulate it. Why do you think the devil went after Eve? He's able to manipulate it. Do you see that? What did they say? They said he's just compassionate. What do you mean he's compassionate? Well, he's for like healthcare and for helping people. Besides, it was his anniversary. Listen, I'm not a Romney supporter. I'm not saying there's not wise, intelligent women in America. I'm telling you that they went after their target audience. And they're making young people and women feel a certain way. And they're succeeding. They're succeeding. Look at this chart of a portrait of American voter preferences. Look down where it says single women. Single women, 56%, I'm sorry, 67% of single women voted for Democrats. Up here at the top it says women, 55 to 44, voted Democrat. This means things are so bad in this country that they want their socialism unmasked. They don't even want a counterfeit. And look at young people. Look down here where it says age, 18 to 29. 60% of young people, 18 to 29, voted Democrat. Well, he's such a nice fella. Why'd you vote for Obama? Well, you know, he wants to help people by giving them health care, right? He's a nice fellow, compassionate. 30-year-old to 44, 52%. You can't even get them to be a Republican. I want them to go beyond being a Republican. You can't even get them to be a Republican. 45 to 64, for the first time, you start edging over where you can start getting a majority. You have to be 45 years old to even begin to think straight in America today. And that's not even thinking straight. That's just beginning the process of logical thinking. The older you get, the greater the margin starts leaning now away from. I guess you do grow older, or you should to some degree, with wisdom, don't you? I mean, as age, you begin to grow a little wiser about things. You can see through a little more fluff. Democrats said Republicans were waging a war on women. It was so crafty that Todd Akin, the media blitz that went after him, it was so bad that the Republicans got down on their knees and says, "I don't approve of Todd Akin. He's a mean man. He shouldn't have said what he said." Wow, it's powerful stuff. Powerful stuff. Powerful. This note also says 2 Timothy, that in the last days perilous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy. For this sort are they which what? Creep into houses and lead captive silly women laden with sins, led away with divers lusts. I'm not telling you that all women are silly. I'm not saying all single women are silly. But I am saying this. There's a lot of silly single women. There's a lot that want to be manipulated. There's a lot of young people that are silly and foolish. Susan J. Carroll, The Disempowerment of the Gender Gap, Soccer Moms in the 1996 Election, says the 1996 elections were truly historic for the first time in history. Feminist activists could legitimately claim that the votes of women elected the President of the United States, which was Bill Clinton. So for the first time in history, the women got together, and if you had not had women voting, you would not have had Bill Clinton. And what a nice president he was. Very respectful of women, wasn't he? He brought honor upon women everywhere. He honored the White House, honored his presidency, and honored women, honored his wife, didn't he? Could there be any more desecration of the whole thing when you look in the book of Revelation that says the whore shall ride the beast, and the beast is using the whore, and then afterwards he hates her and burns her and makes her desolate with fire. He takes that mask off, and there it is. There was Bill Clinton basically, "Thanks, women, I used you." And look at that manipulation of young people. It says in Isaiah 3, "As for my people, children are their oppressors, and women rule over them. O my people, they which lead thee cause thee to err and destroy the way of thy paths." I don't believe you ought to have people voting until they're at least an adult. Say, "Well, if they can die for this country, they can vote." Well, you ought not have them using guns and going out and killing people like that. Unless you had an emergency in America. That's just how I feel about it. So number one, propaganda, people want it that way. Number two, women and young people gave you Obama. Number three, why do we have Obama? Because of minorities kept Obama in power. Look at the race chart. Say, what does that mean? Does it mean these people are something wrong? No. What it means is that they're the prime target for the propaganda, and that they have been using minorities in this country for their own ends, just like they use women, just like they use children. Booker T. Washington wrote a book and tried to tell people, accept responsibility. Let's emphasize responsibility. But remember, what propaganda is if you want to believe a lie, it will help you believe it. You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours. I'll use you to get elected and empowered. And the whole time, I will act like I'm your prince and I'm come to rescue you from the mean people. And minorities, many of them in America, are believing it. Hispanic voters gave the president his winning margin. Nearly 14 million entered the country between 2000 and 2010. Do you realize we came out here to this property in the year 2000 somewhere? Since that time, 14 million documented have entered the country. You say, that's great. Is it really? If they came over here as godly Christians with good principles wanting to vote for wisdom, but what are they doing? They're being manipulated by the powers that be. Our forefathers tried to warn the Pope's bragging. They said, look at this. The Pope's saying he's going to use immigration to change America and destroy our civil liberties. But nobody listened to him. Nobody listened. Samuel Morse, the one that invented the Morse code. Telegraph. No, we're not going to listen to him. He said, I'm telling you, they're trying to destroy the country and bring Catholicism to America by use of immigration. They wouldn't listen to him. The U.S. population was 226 million in 1980. It is now 314 million. What I'm against, we're a multiracial church. And that's a blessing. And we don't recognize, as brothers and sisters in Christ, distinction. But I'm telling you something. What I am against is the propaganda in America. I am against how this propaganda is targeting what they call minorities. And they're manipulating people to destroy this country and turn it into a nation of gangs and poverty and totalitarianism, with a mixture of superstitious Roman Catholicism and humanist liberalism. Now, I know how the propaganda works. Big Mama comes up and says, do you hear what he's saying? He's using the same arguments of whatever, whatever. He's this, and they're going to basically say that they have to protect you from people that are making statements like that. And what I'm telling you, if people want to continue to drink in the propaganda, kiss your country bye-bye. Because it's going to hell. CNN has an article called The New America, What the Election Teaches Us About Ourselves. It wasn't just President Obama's re-election and the diverse coalition of minorities, women, and youth that kept him in power. For the first time, voters approved same-sex marriage in three states. Margaret Hoover, a Republican analyst and CNN contributor, called it a watershed moment. Meanwhile, Wisconsin elected the country's first openly gay U.S. senator. Two states legalized the recreational use of marijuana. A record 20 women will be serving in the U.S. Senate. All this would have been unthinkable a generation ago. Tuesday's election showed that the United States is redefining what it means to be an American, some political and social observers say. The country is less conservative than popular beliefs suggest. It's no longer the same America. The nation has arrived at a new normal. The 60s culture wars won. And that's a legacy that we're now seeing. A bunch of hippies running the country. Said Julian Zelizer, politician, historian, political historian at Princeton University. There is kind of a 1950s America that we lost, Castellano said. It's an old way of looking at the world. Much of the change accompanied Hispanic immigration, which has, quote, profoundly changed the way the country votes, the way it sounds, and the way it looks, Zelizer said. I think Americans are schizophrenic when it comes to conservatism and liberalism, Zelizer said. They often say, I like less government, but when you ask about any specifics, they start to say, we like the government doing that. So, you know where we're at today? People are addicted to the handouts. The only question is who's going to get them. That's what everybody's debating. Who's going to get them? Hispanic's going to get them. Black's going to get them. Who's going to? Women going to get them. Unwed married mother's going to get them. Who's going to get the handout? That's the only thing they're debating. So anybody that stands up and says, maybe we should just stop the whole handout thing. Well, you're a racist German. You don't believe they ought to have handouts. See, that's how you're characterized. That's how you're characterized in America. And it works. It works. Nobody wants to stand up and be the bad fellow. Proverbs 24 says, meddle not with them that are given to change, for their calamity shall rise suddenly. I think God just prophesied to you. It's going to come suddenly. Change, change, peace and safety. We're so happy. Look at our new America. Better get out of the cities. You better get out of the cities of New America. I'm going to hurry along here. Number four, in answering the question of why Obama, you've got to look at the fact that multitudes of Republicans stayed home. How many of you didn't vote? There you go. In spite of everything I just said, they're going to say, delete all that. The reason we have Obama is you. You know what I said? I said, I'm not playing the game no more. I'm not playing the game no more. I did that with George Bush and all that stuff. I'm not doing that no more. I'm not taking a fake. I'd rather have my socialist without his mask than to have a fake one. At least we could all be unified and admit it's wrong. Maybe next time they'll know better. If there is a next time. I think God tried to give a little bit of soundness. I know Ron Paul wasn't perfect, but neither were our founding fathers who set up this country. But they had some things right. They had some good foundational principles for ruling civil government that were right. And I think it's as if God was offering you a chance. You know who refused it? I believe God, in spite of what we say, I believe God was offering, in spite of America's blood, in spite of everything America's done, I think God was offering a chance to start rebuilding and start. And Ron Paul didn't say, I'm going to destroy every. He understands that when you have people on, when you have people dying on pharmaceuticals, you don't say, go home and throw away your pharmaceuticals. We say, bit by bit, replace it with what's good and start easing off. Because some of that stuff you just start getting rid of and it'll mess you up. So Ron Paul was saying, we need to start weaning America off their programs. You know what people did? Christians demonized him. Christian conservatives demonized. And when you say, now wait a second, here's a fellow that can take people from right and left. Here's a fellow that's talking about sound economic constitutional principles. Here's a fellow that in all the polls is basically even right equal or is whipping Obama. What would happen if everybody united around it? Plus he's pulling people from the left and right and he had youth vote. Wow. What could have been done? I don't know. It just looks to me. And this is, I said this to people. I said, you put up one of these George Bush fellas again, and most of the constitutionally minded people are going to stay home or write in somebody else. So really, you have no other option than to not give us a fake conservative this time. They wouldn't listen, would they? They wouldn't listen. So So they gave you somebody that was just a better representation of Obama with a different little spin on things, you know. And people reject, well, we might as well just keep Obama then. Plus it'd be racist to give him a second term. That's how they reasoned. Well, let me conclude my final reason for Obama. This is my fifth point. Remember, five is the number of grace, but in the Bible, it's also the number of death. So my fifth point, remember, people were smitten under the fifth rib. Satan was the fifth fallen cherub. Adam died in Genesis 5. Ananias and Sapphira died in judgment in Acts chapter 5. And so I'm going to tell you that the reason Obama has been elected president is because America's under judgment. And you are judged with Obama. American Christians are judged with Obama. There comes the point where God says, I'll give you what you want. And He's given America what America wants. And a lot of the Christians are angry about it, but they're under judgment too in America today. Has there been a lot of real repentance that you know of in America? For abortion, worldliness, the slop they watch, getting entertainment, eat popcorn as they're watching people tortured and suffering, voting with their own to torture people in America. There's abortion going on all around it. People barely say anything about it. They look the other way. And the Bible said in Proverbs 24, if thou forbear to deliver them that are drawn unto death and those that are ready to be slain, if thou sayest, behold, we knew it not, it's not he that pondereth the heart, consider it, and he that keepeth thy soul, doth he not know it? And shall not he render to every man according to his works? And one of the things he does is he gives you the leaders you deserve. And I believe this drawn unto death is threefold. First thing we ought to do is evangelize people that are going to eternal damnation. We ought to give them the gospel, right? Is there much evangelism going on in American churches today? No, people are too lazy. Then the second thing is you've got chastisement upon Christians. You've got a judgment in the millennial kingdom. You've got a judgment seat of Christ. You ought to deliver Christians by calling them to holiness. You get many Christians going downtown and hitting the streets, calling other Christians to holiness to save them from death. Remember, he that hides a soul saves a sinner. The verse says in James, hides a multitude of sins and saves a soul from death. That's good, isn't it? You ought to save your brother and sister from death. And what about little babies that are dying? What about the slop that people are eating, killing their children? What about the drugs and pharmaceutical witchcraft people are doing to kill themselves and kill their families with, and the death by morphine of our elderly people? All of this. People are silent in America about it. They're silent about death. What's God going to do? The wicked, says Psalm 9, shall be turned into hell in all the nations that forget God. Is America being turned into hell? Yes, it is. Why is America getting turned into hell? Because they're what? Forgetting God. Judges 2. People like to say, where was God when all these school shootings started happening? And they like to give you a little poster, a little tract that says, oh, well, you took me out of school when you took prayer out of school. Well, I want to even go back. I think you took God out. I think God never ordained the whole public state-controlled education system in America. I think that's where you began the problem. I think we're doing fine with church schools and private schools, and that's how it ought to stay. Judges chapter 2, they forsook the Lord and served Baal and Ashtaroth. And the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel. And He delivered them into the hands of spoilers that spoiled them. Mama Obama. And when the Lord raised them up judges, then the Lord was with the judge. You better pray God to give you a judge, amen? You better pray God will raise up some fathers in these homes. God will raise up some preachers around America. And you better pray God will raise up some politicians that say, I know the people don't want me, but I'll try to run and I'll try to do right. The Lord was with the judge. He gave him a little reprieve. Amen? And it came to pass when the judge was dead that they returned and corrupted themselves more than their fathers. You know what's going to save America? Men. You know what's going to save America? Men getting on their face before God and standing up and saying, no more. I'm going to be a magistrate in my home. We're going to have a magistrate in our church. We're going to have a magistrate in our community. We're going to have a magistrate in our land. Do whatever we can to say no more propaganda. Even if I want to believe it, I'm not going to listen to it anymore. It's all a lie from hell. When there was no magistrate in the land that might put them to shame in anything. Boy, that's good, isn't it? Isn't that great? You can come listen to sermons and feel good about yourself. Isn't that wonderful? Yeah, let's see what it gets you. Let's see what it gets you. Proverbs 29, when the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked beareth rule, the people mourn. I don't take this as an immediate rejoicing. When God puts righteous people, you're happy. You know that? If there's a righteous pastors, you got righteous fathers, righteous civil leaders, righteous mamas, people are happy. They're just happy. But when you got weak leaders that are serving themselves and telling you what you want to hear for their own gain, people mourn. They're depressed. They're not happy people. When you got leaders that don't lord over you, but also aren't going to just put up with telling you what you want to hear just so you'll be happy. When you got mamas and daddies and pastors and civil leaders that'll tell you what you need to hear for your own good, that's going to make you happy. That's going to give you joy. So I'm sick of sellouts, aren't you? I'm sick of sellouts. I'm sick of sissified sellouts in America. I'm sick of sissy pastors. I'm sick of sissy fathers. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of sissy sodomite politicians. I'm sick of lying to people, watching people be lied to. So I close with 2 Chronicles 7. If my people, hey, we get in on that today. If my people, which are called by my name, that's us today, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Isn't it worth it for your children? Isn't it worth it for your grandchildren? You say, this isn't our home. I know it's not our home. I know it will be our home one day when Jesus comes and claims it. Amen? Amen. I know this kingdom, this world's not. Heaven's going to come down, and I understand. But you got these people that just want to go live. They want to keep their sins. They don't want to pray. They don't want to turn from their wicked ways. And they want to just sit back and say, oh, well, I'm just not going to care about what's happening around. Oh, is that what Jesus, he went about doing good everywhere he went. You can't find something good to do and try to get in the way of evil? I don't know what Bible these people read sometimes. Let's get in the way of evil, amen? Say, well, you're not going to stop at all. Hey, I could stop a little bit, can I? Let's get in the way of evil. Let's stand up and be men. Praise God for strong ladies. It'll be mamas in Israel. Amen. Sometimes you have to have Deborahs that'll stand up and say, if all you're going to be a bunch of sissies, I'll at least stand up and exhort you to manliness. Amen. Praise God for mamas that'll stand up and want to create men. Want your little boys to be men. Praise God for the young Christian sisters here that are bold. I tell you what, they're on fire. They're not going to put up with a bunch of mess. You understand that? That's what we want, bold children that'll stand up and be arrows, defenders. And I'm done. Thank you for listening to me today. Let's pray. Dear Father, I thank you for your goodness, Lord. Oh, Father, what a mess. Oh, Lord, it's so bad. And Lord, they call me a negative preacher, but God, I was more positive, Lord, to think that it's not so far gone, that people will be this foolish, Lord. But dear Holy God, I've underestimated the power of this wicked propaganda. I've underestimated the power of the television and their manipulation of people's minds. God, is there any hope? You've given us hope here with this verse in Chronicles, Lord. And I claim that today. I pray you'll heal this land. Forgive us of our sins and the sins of our fathers. Forgive us for what we've done to even exceed the sins of our fathers. Forgive us for not having sobriety and understanding that there's going to be payback for everything we're sowing. Lord, I don't know what's coming with Obama. But somehow or another, Lord, I pray you'll have mercy upon us, your people. For I can see history, Lord. I can see your Bible. And it always ends bad, Lord, when people go this way. Help us, Lord. Have mercy. In the name of Jesus, amen.